Hi, welcome to the Behavior Science Overview. This recording is intended to build or strengthen background knowledge in the science of behavior. Let's start by looking at some research-based behavioral principles. We know that behavior is learned and that it can be changed. We'll talk more about that. We also know that lasting behavioral change is more likely with positive rather than punitive strategies. And lastly, no student should be intentionally or unintentionally humiliated or belittled. Let's just start by looking at that fourth bullet for a minute. None of us would try to intentionally humiliate or belittle a student. And I am sure that most of us would be fairly certain that we were not doing it unintentionally either. However, sometimes things like use of sarcasm in an attempt to build rapport with students can unintentionally belittle them or hurt them. I enjoy sarcasm myself, so it's about being very mindful and understanding that while some students may relate very well to that, other students may in fact be unintentionally humiliated or belittled. So, if I asked you to look at these four bullets and choose the one that you would say is probably the most difficult for people and particularly school staff to really embrace, which one would you pick? Most people choose the third one. It's hard for people to wrap their head around behavioral change that lasts is really more likely with positive rather than punitive strategies. Often we hear things like, well, that's not the real world, or we have to prepare our kids for the real world. And actually, the real world uses a lot of positive strategies to change our behavior. So I want to go ahead and show you some of those examples so that we can see the power in the positive strategies. Do you have any of these things in your wallet or maybe on your keychain? These are reward programs or cards that allow us to get things for free or for discounts or different rewards the more we shop. And I don't want to ruin your day, but did you know that they are not just doing it to be nice? Kroger, for example, is not just sending me coupons for 40 cents off butter or for free carrots just because they're nice and they want to thank me. No. Why are they doing it? They're doing it because it gets me back. It shapes my behavior. I will choose going to that store versus another store that doesn't send me coupons for free products, all things being equal. So it's a positive strategy to change my behavior. Here is another real-world example. This is a screenshot of my ATM at Fifth Third Bank. I have a long, embarrassing history of going to the ATM, putting my card in, getting my money out, driving away, and often not until much later do I realize that I had left my card in the machine. Then I have to make sure to go back to the bank and ask them to crawl in and get my card out for me. One of the things they could have done, and I'm surprised that they didn't, is to start charging me a fee for every time they had to go in and retrieve my card. Instead, what Fifth Third did is really set me, or us, up for success using positive strategies, and they changed the process. So now you first have to get your card out, and then you get your money. And no one is going to drive away without their money. Positive strategies to shape our behavior. Here's another example. This is Big B Coffee near my house where I often work. I'll admit that I'm not a great tipper with jars on the counter. Usually just put in my 32 cents change or whatever. I'm a good tipper in restaurants, but not in the counter jars. One of the things that they did one day was this voting situation for the tip jars. Who tips better? And it compels you to tip. I think I put $5 in the women jar that day. Instead of adding 20% to every order for a tip, or just getting frustrated with limited tips coming in, they used a positive strategy to evoke tipping behavior. Again, another positive strategy to change behavior. We have so many of these examples in the real world, but I'll just show you a couple more. Here is another one intending to prevent people from just throwing cigarette butts on the ground. They also created a voting situation. So, which Justin do you prefer, Bieber or Timberlake? And you vote by throwing away your cigarette butt. And here's the last one I'll share. Someone sent this to us, and I believe the picture was taken in the Netherlands. This was an attempt to stop speeding on this certain street. This is actually 3D painted. And I don't know about you, but I think this is surely a positive strategy that would change my behavior if I was speeding down that street. Okay, let's dive a little deeper into behavior science. We do know that our behaviors are learned and they continue because they serve some sort of purpose or function. Think about function kind of like the purpose, reason, or why behavior occurs. And what we know is we do engage in behavior because we have learned that certain outcomes that are desirable to us are likely. We have a mantra that we like to use to help make this a little more clear. And that is, behavior continues because behavior works. If you are a teacher and you're seeing a student engage in the same behavior, say talking out when you're giving instruction, if he's doing that over and over and it's driving you crazy, asking yourself this question helps try to figure out why he might be engaging in this behavior. So, if behavior continues because behavior works, what's happening to explain why he's continuing to do this? And if I think about it, I might realize that I'm giving him a lot of attention every time he talks out. If he continues to do it, my attention is likely a desirable outcome for him, even if he's not completely aware of it, and would explain why the behavior is continuing. Or maybe it's because he's getting a lot of attention from his peers when he's talking out during instruction. Whatever it may be, asking ourselves what's going on that may be continuing this behavior, behavior continues because behavior works, helps us start to get at the reason or the function of the behavior and develop strategies. Otherwise, we can get caught in a vicious cycle. Let's take a look at this vicious cycle that I'm referring to, and then I'm going to go ahead and explain the science behind this. Here we can see what we call the vicious cycle of reinforcing challenging behavior, or vicious cycle for short. We'll start the cycle at the point when a student misbehaves, meaning that they are displaying behaviors that are not appropriate for school per our behavioral expectations. Let's say that a student is laughing and messing around with friends in class instead of completing independent work. I, as the teacher, pay attention to his behavior. That is, I might move over next to him and say, "Kelton, get back to work." And he does. So I'm reinforced for paying attention to his behavior, which makes sense because most of the time a redirection stops the behavior and returns the student to what he should be doing. And the student who wants that adult attention is also reinforced. Now, we know what often happens next. They engage in the behavior again. So I look over at Kelton and he is again talking to the peers around him. I again head back over, pretty annoyed if I'm honest, and I tell Kelton that he needs to stop and get back to work. I might even add a threat of a small consequence, like, or you'll have to, whatever, fill in the blank. Again, Kelton's behavior resulted in me coming over and providing him with attention, so he is reinforced. And I am reinforced for giving him a little threat of a consequence because he momentarily stops. We should not be surprised to see Kelton's behavior occurring yet again, and now we're stuck in this vicious cycle. Sometimes what happens is that I might become so frustrated that I might send him out of class, which negatively reinforces me because I get some relief from this vicious cycle between Kelton and I, and Kelton might also be negatively reinforced by escaping the work. He also could be possibly reinforced by getting to engage with an adult in the office or wherever I have sent him out of the class to. And now we are stuck, and this is where our human nature wants us to apply punishment, big punishment, to make this stop. Let's take a look at the science of behavior to see why this just isn't effective and how to prevent getting caught in this cycle. Here is the classic foundational unit of understanding behavior, A, B, C. We have a behavior that occurs. Something always happens before the behavior, antecedent, and something always occurs after the behavior, consequence. When we speak of consequences, we typically think of punishment. In behavior science, the word consequence simply refers to whatever happens after the behavior. It could be punishing, it could be reinforcing. It simply refers to what happens immediately after the behavior occurs. You could use the word response instead to make it more clear. Let's say a student has a fight, that's the behavior, and is suspended. If the student does not want to be in school, he may learn that fighting is a good way to get sent home, which for some students can be very reinforcing. In this case, fighting resulted in a desirable consequence, being home, and it was reinforcing for the student, even though the intention was for it to be punishment and stop the fighting behavior. So if the student really wants to be home, might we see the fighting behavior again? Likely. Let's play this out with a real-life example. My behavior is speeding. The antecedent is that I'm running late for work. So I speed, my behavior, because it's very important for me to get to work on time. And almost all of the time, my behavior works. So my behavior is reinforced. My speeding behavior becomes reinforced. Now, do you suppose there are punitive consequences for speeding that I am aware of? Yes. The problem is that the consequence of a speeding ticket is not a big enough stick for me to change my behavior. Getting to work on time due to my behavior, speeding, is so reinforcing that unless a police officer is following me 100% of the time, I will continue to use that behavior despite the risk of punitive consequences because it works for me. And the same is true for students. Often the response that they are getting from their behavior, such as attention from peers or teachers or being able to avoid tasks, is way more powerful than the threat of the punishment options that we tend to use. This is why it becomes so critical to support behavior proactively before it occurs. So, what are the antecedent or prevention strategies that I can use to change my speeding behavior, thereby rendering my speeding unnecessary? Setting my alarm earlier, having my husband wake me up, having a coworker pick me up, organizing my morning. These proactive antecedent strategies make the behavior unnecessary and have much more power in reducing or eliminating my speeding than punishment does. Now I don't have to speed to get to work on time. I get my need met by changing the antecedent, and I am reinforced because it works. This same principle applies to students. So three big takeaways. One, behavior does not exist in isolation. There is always an antecedent and a consequence. Two, anytime a student exhibits a behavior, acceptable or unacceptable, that is successful in meeting one of his or her needs, it is likely that the behavior will be repeated. Behavior continues because it works. And three, we need to problem solve antecedent prevention strategies at much higher rates than applying punitive consequences in order to reduce behavioral challenges. Now that we better understand the science of behavior, let's look at what some possible functions of behavior are. Remember, by function we mean purpose, reason, or why. Basically, it boils down to, as human beings, we are trying to get something or avoid something, in essence. This slide just shows you some different possibilities for the functions of behavior for some of your students or yourselves. As an example, I always ask people about teeth brushing. Why did you brush your teeth today? People will say things like to get fresh breath, to avoid cavities, and so on. So even something as benign as teeth brushing has a function behind it. Let's practice ABC with a typical student behavior. Look in the behavior B column. What is the student's behavior? What happened before the behavior? Where do we look? Yep. Antecedent column, and we see that when the student was given a writing assignment, then he started making noises and talking to others and not working. What happened after the student engaged in this behavior? Where do we look? Yep, the consequence column. Remember, consequence doesn't just mean punishment, it means what comes after a behavior. So, what happened after the student was making noises, talking to others, and not working? He was redirected, reminded to get to work, and then sent to the office. So, what might the student be getting or avoiding that maintains this behavior if it occurs over and over? Well, maybe getting sent to the office allows him to avoid the task, which might be challenging for him, and it's more reinforcing to be sent to the office to escape that task than to try to do it. We'd have to know more, of course. But let's presume he is engaging in this behavior to avoid the hard writing task. What strategies might meet this same function for him? A framework called Prevent, Teach, Respond, which aligns with the ABC of behavior science, helps provide us with guiding questions that will assist in action planning and selection of strategies and interventions. When we think about antecedents, we think about prevention. The question here is, what can we do to prevent problem behaviors from occurring in the first place? What strategies can we use so the student doesn't have to engage in misbehavior to get their needs met? Then, when we think about behavior, we think about teaching. How can we use effective teaching techniques to teach new and replacement behaviors? And lastly, we use consequence to think about how we respond. How do we respond to behaviors in ways to reinforce behavior we want to see more of? And how do we respond in ways that do not reinforce the inappropriate behaviors, and also in ways that would prevent further escalation of problems? Let's return to our example of the student that was not working, making noises, and talking with others when given a writing assignment. What strategies could we implement to prevent the student from engaging in this behavior? If he's avoiding the task because it's hard, we could prevent the behavior by providing some scaffolding, such as sentence frames, peer partners, or direct support to get started. Notice that this team included give extra time and then crossed it off. Why? If the task is hard for the student, will providing extra time help prevent the behavior? Likely not. Another set of strategies include teaching. What behaviors can we teach the student to do rather than engage in behavior to avoid the challenging task? We could teach them how to ask for help. Many students don't know how to do this or how to do it in a way that doesn't embarrass them in front of peers. We could also teach them to use a graphic organizer to support the writing task. And lastly, how might we respond in ways that reinforce the behaviors we want to see? We could provide frequent and positive feedback while he is working, especially when he first starts the assignment. And we could praise the student for simply getting started. After teaching how to ask for help, we could prompt the asking for help the moment we announce the assignment or as soon as we see him start to engage from the work. We always want to make sure that these strategies still allow the function of behavior to be met. To end this recording, we are going to ask you to pause and stop and reflect. Please jot down the following in your guided notes and bring them with you to the upcoming training. What is one aha that you had as you listened to this recorded webinar? What is one piece of previous learning, something you already knew, that was reinforced or confirmed? And lastly, what is one way that you could see this being important for application in the classroom? Thank you so much for your time, and we hope that your understanding of behavior science has been strengthened.